Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Welcome to Berks Pro-Life. We have a full hour to speak with a very special person tonight. We are going to be presenting by Skype, Jeffrey McCall. And he's been very gracious to talk to us by Skype. And the program is called Freedom March. He's going to tell you all about it. My name is Carolyn Bonkoski. I'm co-host with our host and producer, Kathy Kuhns.
Good evening. Hi.
And we'll have a few announcements at the end of the program, so don't leave until we're finished. Okay. All right, I want to start with Jeffrey. I want to introduce him, and he is the founder of the Freedom March. He is an author, and he is a speaker. So first of all, Jeffrey, could you tell us about your early life and some of your struggles?
Yes. So to begin... Like the great host said, my name is Jeffrey McCall. I'm calling out of Georgia. To begin about my life was quite different. From an early age, I started having attractions towards other men. And it was around the age of 12 that I had my first thoughts of being with another man in an intimate way. And so by the age of 15 years old, my whole identity was about the sexuality that I felt. So that kind of leads up to what I do now and what I share about now. It was a beginning of just really a lot of confusion in my life. My parents were divorced from the time I was very young. And during that period, that confused me, the dynamic of a marriage and how it's supposed to look. I also saw things from an older male I shouldn't have seen. And so there's just a lot of confusion that led me to these same-sex attractions. And that's kind of how my story begins.
I'm going to let people know that we do have the opportunity to take viewers' phone calls. The number, if you would like to call in and ask Jeffrey something, is 610-378-0426. I think you'll see that on your screen. It's 610-378-0426. So we do ask you again to be respectful. And I think Kathy has
and
a question
Jeffrey,
for you.
Jeffrey, I just want to say thank you for being so open and honest and sharing your story, because it is a tremendous story. And we hope that you'll be able to give some hope to other people who are suffering from same-sex identity issues and who really want to change. And I read your book, by the way, I have to say. It's very sad, very hard reading. My goodness, all the things, all the deaths of people in your life. And what's the name of the book again? I forgot. It's
So I have the book here, too. It's called For Such a Time.
Yes, okay. Yeah, okay. And I don't know if everybody can see that, but you can get it on Amazon. You can get it on Kindle, too, if you want to quickly read it after the program. But... I just can't tell you. It's just a miracle, your whole life. So I'm sorry, I didn't want to interrupt you. So you were talking about your early life?
Yeah, so that was my early years. And then from there, so like I wrote about in the book, at 15 years old, my oldest brother passed away suddenly. He was in his 20s. It was just unexpected, from a seizure. And that happened so my first encounter with a male was on one day, a Sunday. Then 7 days later, the next Sunday, my oldest brother died. So my life spiraled into just a different world. I felt like my innocence was taken away. And I also felt like a huge part of my family was destroyed. And so it was then at 15 years old that I really just dove into another life and another identity. I started messing around with drugs and alcohol. By 18 years old, I moved to the city closest to me, which was Nashville, Tennessee, the city closest that had an LGBTQ community. And my identity was being LGBT. That was my identity, was being part of that community. At 18 years old, I was dating a man in his mid-30s, 34, somewhere around that. age, and I just became obsessed with him and just went to the club and did what I want with him. And my life was just always, my identity through all these years was just partying, drugs, and my sexuality. My sexuality was like my identity. And so from 18 to 23, it was just a lot of partying. Around 22, 21, I started experimenting with crystal meth. And when I started doing crystal meth, I was doing ecstasy. I was just doing all these things. I got a job at a club. The club actually opened at 1 in the morning, and it closed at 8 in the morning to the public. Then there would be ongoing after parties. So all these years, I'm just partying, doing drugs. That was my life. And I was just really just, I say, like, inside morally and spiritually, I was just felt bankrupt. Like, my life had no purpose. It had no meaning. And that was when, around 23 years old, I'm almost 6'4", and I was weighing about 160-something. I think the lowest I ever weighed was in the high 150s. And I got physically sick. Here I am trying to do crystal meth. I was addicted to pills and Xanax, do all these things. And it was taking a toll on my physical body. So it was then that I actually stopped just everything. I said, if I don't get off the drugs, I'm going to die. So I actually, I left everything I knew in Nashville, Tennessee at 23 years old. And I moved in with my father. And so from there,
can I just stop you there 1 minute?
Yeah.
Where were your parents through all this? Did they try to help you, or did you have any other relatives that tried to help you?
I had great parents. Both of my parents are Christian parents. You know, they made mistakes like we all do, but they were amazing parents. From those ages of 18 to 23, I just moved far away. I would be far away from them or be in another location and just see them. You know, I was an adult. I was over 18 years old. I lived in other places. So, like, they were around if I needed help, but I would distance myself so much from them. So that's basically how that happened.
Well, Jeffrey, what did you do for income?
So, like I said, at one point I worked at that club, the After Hours Club. So it was the After Hours Club for the regular clubs. Like I said, it opened at 1 and closed at 9. So this is where people, the bartenders and people that were in adult entertainment and all those things in the city, when those places closed down at 3, they would come to this club. I worked at that club for a while, so there was some income there.
And what did you do at the club? What was your job at the club?
I actually would just check people in or run the little bar area in there, stuff like that.
So you were a bartender?
There's no alcohol served in After Hours clubs. Mm. They're not allowed to have alcohol permits. So I ran, like, just they had drinks and different things like that, but there weren't alcohol. Yeah, I kind of ran that area.
I see. And then so, when you left, what did you do for income?
So when I left, are you talking about when I left Nashville?
Yes.
So I left Nashville, and I was 23 years old. Like I said, I was sick, physically sick from all the drug use. And I knew that I had to leave Nashville. So that's when I was going into, I left and moved in with my dad. And that's where I started college. And he let me live with him at 23 years old and go to school full time. And so that's what I did there. I went to school full time in Georgia. I left everything in Nashville and went to Georgia. And for 4 years, I went to school full time. And I actually got off all the illegal drugs and things like that. And so people on the outside thought, oh my gosh, he's doing so good. He's in college full time. I was getting, like, honors. I graduated with honors at my college. I won the history award for the history department. I was doing good with what it looked like on the outside those 4 years. My life had changed so much from the illegal drugs and all that. But inside, still, I was just, like, empty. So on the outside, it looked like I was doing so much better and I was off the drugs and I'm in college. You know, what the world says is good, which there are good aspects to that. But inside, nothing had changed those 4 years. And then that's when my life changed into where Scarlet comes in, where I live transgender.
So this is the part that is, when I read your book, I was just shocked, really. Tell us about Scarlet.
So the summer after I graduated college, I had done so well as an undergrad that I had talked to three different schools about graduate school, and I got a scholarship to be a professor's aide to go and get my master's in history at East Tennessee State University up back in Tennessee. But this was in a part of Tennessee I didn't live in, far East Tennessee, near the Virginia line. So since I got a scholarship there, I said, you know what, even though I kind of wanted to go to another one a little bit more, I said, I'll go to that one. They're paying. I'll have a master's degree when I'm done in history. That's what I want to teach one day. So I said, I'll move up there to Johnson City, Tennessee. So I left everything behind. I was going to be hours from my family in Georgia, even further from my family in Middle Tennessee. And I moved up there to that far little corner of Tennessee. I thought, you know, I'm going to get my master's and my life's going to begin here. Well, that summer before starting graduate school, I did my first drag show. Now, growing up in the LGB community, I was always around people that identified as transgender, transsexual, drag queens. I was around people like that. My cousin was a show performer in Nashville and had done shows in Florida. So I grew up around those people. Once I was in the community by 18, I grew up around a lot of those people that identified as that. So there in moving to go to graduate school in Johnson City, that summer before starting school, I did my first show. I just wanted to do it. There was just something, you know, from a little boy when all these things were going on in my life, I always felt more feminine. I always felt like I was, like, some part of me was a woman or, you know, feminine. And I remember that summer before, it was like all the thoughts and ideas of, like, maybe I'm more feminine. And I remember hearing just, like, my mind going, saying, you know, you didn't even work out in homosexual relationships. None of the things worked out with your boyfriends because you're really a woman in a man's body. You need to transition and be a woman. And so that summer, I'll never forget, I did my first show, and then from there it was starting. And it wasn't just shows. I eventually quit the shows and started living as Scarlett. I started seeing, during those 2 years of graduate school, I started seeing psychologists and psychiatrists. And by my second year of graduate school, the psychiatrist told me, you have gender dysphoria. You are really a woman in a man's body. And he told me, he said, I've worked with other people before. He said, you can begin to start having surgeries, or you can begin hormones, or you can begin both. And I remember I told him, I told the psychiatrist, I said, this is great. This is who I am. This gender dysphoria, that's what's wrong, been wrong with me. I need to transition. I need to become this other person. And I remember thinking that and believing that. And I remember I told him, I said, I do not want to start hormones. I said, what I do want to start is surgeries. I said, because hormones take years sometimes to see a change. I said, I want quick change and I want it fast. I said, I want to start surgeries as soon as I have the money for that. He was basically like, yeah, that's, you know, you can do that. And basically he was giving me that diagnosis of gender dysphoria, which is what I needed. I needed doctors. I needed to have, I think, 2 diagnoses of gender dysphoria before I could have major surgeries in the future.
Well, Jeffrey, when he said, as soon as you have the money, what kind of money are you talking about? What does it take? How much does that cost?
Well, like a breast implants would be anywhere between $3,000 to $10,000, depending on who did it. Wow. Hip augmentations, I don't know how much those are, probably around anywhere between $5,000 and $10,000. I mean, I was literally going to reshape my whole body the way I did.
And weren't you afraid to go under the knife? Did you ever consider that it would be scary?
Yes, I thought it was going to be scary in a way, and I want to show pictures.
Yeah, could you show your picture when you were Scarlett? That is,
yeah, show that. So that, can y'all see it as Scarlett?
No, I see your hand, but not the picture.
Oh, there. Okay, I think they can see it. That's you, right?
Yes. That's me, and this is me right here. More of my face, you can see me, but yeah, this was me during those years.
Okay.
That's Scarlett, and so,
yes. So you were Scarlett.
He was Scarlett.
You were Scarlett. You changed your name to Scarlett.
Right.
Yeah, so I went by the name of Scarlett. I started going to my graduate classes as Scarlett. I started talking to my professors, and at this school, they were very like, yeah, we'll accept you no matter what, and you can be Scarlett or whoever you want. And so that was my life. And I started just going out with guys. I started dating guys as Scarlett. I started going to clubs as Scarlett, all these things. And the further I went into becoming scarlet, the more I started drinking. Drinking had always been a part of my life because in the drug scene and all those scenes, you drink when you're out, but people that are on the drugs more don't try to be drunk. Drinking is its own thing. And I remember I never was really a drinker like that, but the further my life got out of control, the further I went into drinking. And when I was living in Scarlet, I would drink whiskey and vodka all the time. I would get very drunk, go out with these guys. I remember the further I went into Scarlet, I even lost my identity with the LGBTQ community. I was so into what I believed I was from the psychiatrist and what I was hearing, what I was believing, that I was really a woman in a man's body. I'm transitioning to Scarlet. This is who I'll become. I'm really a woman. I'm not really even in the LGBTQ community. Not really. And so I started going out with these guys. I went out with guys that had never even been with another man or another transgender or transsexual. I was very good at what I did. I looked completely different than how I looked. And that was my life. I thought, you know, I'm going to have these surgeries. My body's going to be completely changed. And when I live as Scarlet, I will find a husband and we will get married and we will adopt children. And that was what my idea of life was. But I noticed that the further I tried to become something I wasn't, the heavier everything got. The more depressed I got, the more promiscuous I got. And then there came an incident where I was dating an individual, and this guy couldn't make it to something one weekend that we were supposed to do. And I was already had started drinking that day. And I remember I just busted up my whole apartment. I was very just like depressed. And I remember thinking thoughts of hurting myself. And I remember I called the campus security for help, and I just told them, like, I'm just not in the right place. I'm thinking of, you know, suicide and harming myself and just all this crazy stuff. And I really was. There was a part of me that was truly believing that and thinking that. And there was also this part of me that wanted help. It felt like it was screaming out for help, and nobody was helping me. And I remember I got help. They sent me to the hospital. I was in the psychiatric part of the hospital for 2 days, and they sent me to a psychiatric facility that helps evaluate your mental state and what's going on. And they, you know, after a couple of days, the doctor's like, look, you're in graduate school. You got drunk. You had a meltdown. People do that. I'm going to let you go and you go back to school. And I remember I got out. I went back to classes and just continued my downward spiral from there. And it was
Jeffrey, did you continue as Scarlet while you're doing... When you went back after the hospital event?
Yes, ma'am. So after the hospital event, when I got out, I continued as Scarlet. I actually was living as Scarlet in the psychiatric facility. They let me stay as Scarlet. I did not want to come out of the makeup, the clothes, how I padded, dressed, all those things. And they basically let me stay as Scarlet in there.
And the men that you were dating, how did they receive you?
Yeah, so the man that I was dating, he actually knew that I was, you know, transgender and stuff, and he accepted me as that. He had dated a transgender person before, and so that was something he was fine with. This guy was just a normal country guy. You would probably never even expect to be dating someone that's a transgender woman, but that's how it was, and it was just a thing, and he accepted me for what I thought I was.
So he wasn't part of the LGBT community then?
He was not really a big part of the LGBTQ community, no.
No.
I didn't even think he identified as any of that, any of the LGBT or Q. And also, it was around this time of this event that I also pushed for transgender rights. I did an ABC, a local ABC interview. You know, there's CBS, ABC, NBC in most cities in the Tri-City areas of Tennessee. They have all those. And I did an interview with ABC, the local ABC channel, when I went as Scarlet the first day of class. I told them, I said, look, I'm living as Scarlet. I'm living transgender. Tomorrow's my first day that I'm going to class as Scarlet. And I want to let y'all know, I think it'll be a good story. And so I started partnering with this other multicultural center to push all these equality rights and all these things. And, so I did the ABC interview with Scarlet. I was very public about my life and what I believed. And then everything changed. Everything changed, quickly during that time because God started pulling on my heart in a totally different direction than what I was living.
What do you think caused the change? Do you have any, do you have any idea what might have, you know, things started to change? Do you have any idea what might have started that change?
Yeah, so there were so many things that the Lord used. I remember that I started questioning everything. I said, if this is right and this is who I am, why do I feel depressed? Why did I feel suicidal? Why do I feel like I'm needing help? Why do I feel like something just isn't quite right with this? And I remember I started watching this man who was a preacher who came on TV, because I wasn't going to go to church, but I had heard of this man, Jensen Franklin, who's a pastor on television. And so I said, you know, I could listen to him. I'd watch YouTube videos. Here I am living in Scarlet, and I'm like secretly listening to this pastor. And I remember I would hear some sermons he would preach, and I would just cry. I felt conviction. I felt like something that wasn't quite right is because the Lord had something better for me, something different. And I remember the night that I really was affected. I was at my apartment alone. It was late. I remember it was so late. I was alone, and there was no guy that night I was with, and none of that. And I just was alone, and I remember going in my bedroom. And when I went in my bedroom, I just like collapsed on my bed, and I was weeping. And I said, God, I know people live for you. I know there are people that have joy and peace and love. Like, really, something happened in their life. Something real happened. Something shifted. And I even remember telling God, I said, and it's not about going to church on Sunday. I said, it's not about that with them. That's great. But like, I said, something happened in these people's lives. And I had met a few people that I really felt that something happened in their life. And I just cried out to God saying that. I was weeping. I was distraught. I was thinking, I'm the furthest you can get from God. I had prostituted my body. I had been with all these men. I had done all this crazy stuff. And
you didn't have any, you didn't get any real help from the psychiatrists and psychologists, did you? It doesn't sound like it. You had those questions, and you weren't able to get the answers from the professional people, which seems rather odd. I mean, why do you suppose that was? Do you think this was more a spiritual problem than a physical problem?
Yes, I think it was a mixture of some physical along with spiritual. I mean, it was very spiritual. It was very spiritual what was going on. Let me turn this light on. It's getting dark here. But yes, it was a very spiritual thing. And like I was going into it, the story, so I cried out to God, and this is the spiritual part. I cried out to God, and I was saying all these things, and I just remember sitting there on that bed thinking, you are the furthest you can be from God. Like, this is out there. And so I said all those things, and I said at the end, I said, God, but will I ever live for you? I don't even know why I said it. I didn't know where it came from, but there was something deep inside of me that wanted to live for God. And all I knew about God was growing up in church, hearing about God. I heard people talk about God. I heard people say what they thought about God. I heard what the LGBTQ community says about God. I heard all these things my whole life. But something deep inside of me wanted to ask God, will I ever live for you? There was like a faith that night, just believing in him. And I'll never forget, crystal clear, all my thoughts through all the sobbing and crying and emotions, all my mind went it was so peaceful. It was still. Everything got still. And I heard him crystal clear. Just, it ran across my mind. He said, yes, you will live for me. And I remember I thought, oh my gosh. I said, the God that created everything we see and like put this whole thing into motion just spoke to me and said I would live for him. I was so stunned. I always heard about God, but I didn't think God communicated with us or took time for us or anything like that. That night I found out that he loved me, that he did say I would live for him, that he was going to put me on a totally different path. And I remember if for like months and months later, I still lived as Scarlet. I remember I just shoved that further and further back. And it was months later, I had moved back to Nashville. I was living at Scarlet, and I was working downtown as a waiter. And I remember I just had another bad night. It was one bad thing after another with guys, with just parties, things that were out of control. And I called my dad. I said, I need to come back to Georgia. And my dad said, yeah, you can come back. And so I moved back with him to Georgia. And I said, this time, this isn't going to be an outside thing for everyone to be like, oh, you're doing good because you're in college and doing well and off illegal drugs. I knew it wasn't going to be like that. I knew this time this was about to be the biggest change of my life, that something internal was going to have to happen. And that summer it did. Oh my goodness, it happened. I remember I had such a problem with creation because of all those years of history degrees and all that. They teach about archaeology and evolution and all the stuff in the Bible is phony and it can never have happened. And I remember I had such a problem with creation. And that summer, I threw away my life at Scarlet. The Lord just healed my mind about creation and started showing me all these people with PhDs and videos on YouTube and all these people that supported creation and the things that supported it. God set us into orbit. God created us. And so then when I believed God created me, I didn't think I was just something that evolved. It doesn't matter who I'm with sexually or what I think or what I do. I thought, oh my gosh, we're all here for a purpose. We're all here because He loves us. We're all here for destiny to fulfill from the God that created everything. And then I accepted really Jesus. I accepted that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. And it wasn't even like a moment of a day. It was like time and time and days and days. And I remember just learning more about the Lord, and that, and I just couldn't believe it, that Jesus Christ would die from what I did, all the bad stuff I did. He would die for it and die for you and every single person. And that was when I accepted Him, that Jesus was the Son of God, and I accepted Him. And my life changed. I'll never forget the day that the Lord led me. He was leading me to make a video and cut ties with everything. And I just said, okay, I'm doing it. And I made a video on Facebook, a Facebook Live video. And I basically just all out said, hey, everyone, I'm not living in homosexuality anymore. I'm not living as Scarlet anymore. I'm not going to be on the pills and drunk and all these things. And that's how I cut off my old life. I just,
What made you do that? What made you do that video?
Well, I'll never forget what made me do that. That would have been God. I was at a church event and I walked outside and I heard so clear God say, you're going to have to cut ties with your past and you're going to make a video. When you make this video, this is what's going to cut the past with you. And I'll never forget, I didn't do it for 2 weeks.
That was like your line in the sand.
Yes, yeah. That was it. Because no one, all this stuff was going on, but no one knew, you know? And so I made that video. When I made that video, I got bombarded. Thousands of people saw the video. They were writing me saying, what do you mean you're leaving homosexuality or you're not going to become Scarlet? You can't do that. Nobody can do that. This is who you are. Get over it. Stop thinking this and just be who you are. And I remember thinking and saying, no, that's not who I am. That's who I believed I am. That's who people told me I am. And that's what people tell other people that they are. But when I read the Bible, when I got with God, He was not telling me this is who I was. He was telling me that He created me as Jeffrey and that He loves me. And that He wanted me to follow and obey Him. And that if I did, that would build that relationship with Him. And it would cut the ties with the past. And when I made that video, I got cut the ties with the past. I lost almost everybody. People that I was friends with since I was a little kid.
Is that right? Wow.
Wow. Yeah. You think it might have been the opposite. You know, people would have
supported you.
Especially when you were small and they knew you as Jeffrey.
Yeah, I lost probably, I would say when I talk about it, probably like 95% of the friends that I grew up with, including some family that I was close with, that only saw me as that identity. And when I told them that I was leaving it to become a Christian, they would not accept me.
Oh, it was because you were becoming a Christian, not because you were dropping the...
Yeah, I mean, because they saw me as a Christian, saying that homosexuality was something I didn't want to be a part of, and transgender, all these things, they saw that as like... And these were people that told me, we're your friends no matter what, you know, as I lived in
Scarlet. Yeah, that's what I would think.
Wow. Scarlet. But then when I became a Christian, it was like, that was too far. Like, they couldn't accept that. And that was okay. Like, I lost people, but I'll never forget. I had so much peace and joy and all those things I asked the Lord about that other people had. I remember I had so much of that that it was just, it was somewhat easy when I lost all those people. Because for months and months and months, I didn't have any friends. I didn't have anyone pulling on me. And all my time was in the Bible and praise and worship and prayer and just speaking to God and listening. And He changed my whole life. And I'm so glad I had that time completely alone with Him.
Oh, that's nice.
So, wow. Jeffrey, what did you do with your career?
I saw in your book you actually got some honors when you graduated. You're a smart guy.
Oh, well, thank you. Yes, I did get those honors in graduating, and I went on to get the master's. I did get it. I taught for 1 year. I taught at a Christian college, Emmanuel College. It's here in Georgia. And while I was there, it was just amazing. They are a Christian school, and they would let me share my testimony with the students and talk to them. It was just amazing. And that year was just so awesome with the students. They were so engaging, and they loved that I talked about real things with them. And you know, we would have a little devotion from the Bible or read a current event, talk about what the Lord talked about with these events. And my students just loved me. I love them. It was so hard because near the middle of the end of the second year, the Lord led on my heart and said, I need you to leave your job as a professor and I need you to go in full-time ministry. And I remember thinking, oh my gosh, like this is, I love this. Like, and I'm at a Christian college. I get to engage with them. Like, this is amazing. There's no way I could leave this. But the Lord led on my heart and just told me, I need you to leave this. There are so many people that need the encouragement that you bring, that need the story that you bring, that there is hope for everyone. And I was obedient to the Lord. And I'll never forget, even some people are like, oh my gosh, you're leaving your job as a history professor. Like, you went to college for that, and you did this or that. You got your bachelor's and your master's for this, and now you love it, and now you're going to leave it? And I just remember, I just stepped out in faith. I left it. I wanted to please God more than anyone else. And even though it didn't look right to the world, that you go to college, you do all these things, and you get in a career, and that's what you do. And that's okay for a lot of people. The Lord just would not let me do that. So, I'm sorry. The Lord would just not let me do that. So I stepped out of faith. I left my job as a ministry professor, and now I'm in a full-time ministry, just sharing my testimony with people, and that's what I do. I travel, and that's what I'm doing this weekend with the Freedom March.
Yeah. So tell us about how did you get the idea for the Freedom March, and how did you get it started?
Yes. So the Freedom March came to me, and I was actually sent to D.C. in September of 2017 to another event. And while I was there, I'll never forget, I was supposed to share my testimony at this event in Washington, D.C. And while I was there, it just came to me in my mind. I said, wait a minute. I said, everybody is marching all over this country for all kinds of things and standing up for what they believe in, all these different things. I said, we need to have a march where people that left LGBTQ lifestyles because of their convictions from or their religious ideas, whatever, that those people that left those lifestyles can come together and have a public platform to share their stories. I said, no one's giving them sharing their stories, and the mainstream media is not sharing their stories, and a lot of churches and Christians don't want to share their stories. It makes some people feel uncomfortable. So I said, I want to have a place where we get to share their stories because their stories matter and their stories are real and their stories encourage other people in the LGBTQ lifestyles that there's another way. And so that's what I started. And last year we had one in D.C. on May 5th. Then we had Los Angeles on November 4th. And then this year we have D.C. again, Saturday, May 25th, this coming Saturday. And then we have St. Paul, Minnesota, the end of June, June 23rd. And then we have Orlando, Florida, September 14th. So we're taking it around the country to different cities. We always have D.C. every May to be the national one. But that's what we're doing. We're sharing that
that's wonderful. How is the march being received in those cities? Have you had any problems?
Yes, so the march is, we actually haven't had a lot of problems. they're actually growing rather quickly. We had between 50 and 75 people show up at DC, the first one last year. People from all over the country, different states. People flew in from California. It was awesome. Like I said, between 50 and 75, we didn't take an exact number. Then in LA, just a couple months later, November 4th, we had probably between 200 and 300. We didn't take a call. I mean, it was three times almost as much. So it is just crazy how fast it's growing. Our one in DC Saturday, we have people emailing, writing from all over the country, coming in, flying in, driving into DC. So we don't even know what to expect Saturday.
The people who come to the march, are they all recovering people, or are there other people who just come to offer their support?
Yeah, we have other people that just come.
Because I'd like to go, but I can't.
Yeah, we have other people that come and just listen to the testimonies and hang out with the people and stuff like that. So we would love anyone to come that wants to come. Even if you have opposing views to what I believe and what our group believes, we still want everyone to come and to listen, because these people's stories do matter. And I will make sure that these people's stories have a platform to share.
I saw on the website for the Freedom March, it looks like it's pretty evenly divided between women and men. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. We have about half men, half women. We have people from Asian backgrounds, Hispanic backgrounds, Caucasian backgrounds, African-American backgrounds. We are such a diverse group, and of all ages, you know, it's just amazing. We all come together and share that we follow Jesus Christ, and that we love him, and that we want to honor him and obey him. And the teachings of the Bible is what we believe. And we do it all in love. We do it all in grace and truth. We share in love, and we love everyone, even people that oppose us. We love them. And we know that Jesus, we know how important those people are. I don't care who you are, what you've done. When you look at people, how Jesus looks at people, that he would be spit on and mocked and beaten and crucified. When you look at someone that he loved them that much, I love them because he loves them and he wants them and he wants all of them.
Do you have support groups around the country that people can go to in addition to the march?
We don't have support groups, and we offer no counseling through the Freedom March. We just basically have our focus, and what we feel the Lord's wanting us to do is stay in our lane and have these marches all over and share people's testimonies. And we direct people to other people that do counseling. There's so many groups that we direct people to that do counseling that are great.
And you have, in addition to the LGBT, you also have people who are, they call it detransitioning, I think is the term that they're using, when they were, they changed their sexual orientation and their bodies, and then they want to go back to their original.
Yes, ma'am. We have one lady that's sharing in Orlando. She lived as a male. She lived through a lot of surgeries as a male, all these things. She's now living back as a woman, proclaiming her life through the Lord Jesus Christ, how he changed and transformed her life. We do not minister any conversion therapy that we're like trying to physically change people's minds. What we say is that the Holy Spirit of God can transform anyone's life. And if you have the power of God on your side, he'll get you through anything, and he'll give you the grace to get you through anything, and he can transform your life. But we don't try to tell people like, you need to physically rewire your brain and change and all that stuff. That's just works of the flesh. We're not into that. We're into the power of the Holy Spirit changing someone's life.
Well, how can people contact you and find out about your march? Do you have
a website?
Do you want to?
freedomtomarch.com. They can always find me on Facebook, Jeffrey McCall. They can also find the Freedom March on Facebook, but the actual website is freedomtomarch.com. And they can always go to my website and email me, which is the4suchatime.org.
Oh, that's interesting. Just one last question. How about your family? How is your relationship with your father and the rest of your family? What do they think of you now?
Oh, yeah. It's amazing. My family's been really amazing. They support me. They love me. So I have a really good relationship with both. And both of my parents are Christians. And it's just been really awesome seeing all the restoration that God did to my family.
That's wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Jeffrey. It has been a blessing. And I just thank you for your courage and your willingness to share your story, because you have quite a story. And I'm sure there are other people that can identify with your struggle and maybe even have had a worse one. But yours is pretty bad.
Yeah.
So thank you.
I'm honored to do it.
Thank you so much.
And we wish you good luck with your book. It's For Such a Time is the name of your book, and it's available on Amazon.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Jeffrey.
Thanks.
All right.
We have a few announcers. Wasn't he wonderful? Just
very brave.
Very courageous.
Very brave.
We want to just have a couple minutes here to talk about some of the upcoming events that are happening. On June 18th, in Harrisburg, 1 to 2 in the Capitol Rotunda, there's going to be a pro-life rally. It's called Stand Up for Life Rally. Anybody can go, but of course, it's supporting pro-life legislation, and there'll be some keynote speakers. And we've had these rallies before. They're always just an exciting event. And many of the legislators come down and you know, participate. So it's a good event. Then on June 28th from 4 to 6, we're going to be doing the National Pro-Life Bridge Day. Now, this is a national event, but we're going to be doing ours from 4 to 6. And we'll be on the overpass on Berkshire Boulevard that crosses 422. So you can come and help hold signs. We have big banners, and it's a lot of traffic. We've talked about it before. It's a busy place, so it's always fun to be there and have everybody honking. And
we did that fun. Last year.
It's
as soon as you pass the Berkshire Theater, it's, you know, you cross over
and
the bridge.
It's safe.
The bridge.
There's parking.
Plenty parking.
You can bring kids. There's not a lot of traffic, so
it's,
you don't have to worry.
Safe place to stand.
Yeah.
And the truckers will go honk honk, and people are giving you that thumbs up, and
it's fun. But we go 4 to 6 because the traffic is so heavy on a Friday.
I think we counted 500.
Something like that. We had a huge
a minute or something. It's a very busy highway on a Saturday.
Yeah. So, and then, of course, we want to remind you all, tomorrow is Election Day, to vote. Get out there and do your civic duty. I'm sure you saw those candidates on before. So there are a lot of candidates running for mayor. My goodness. It's exciting. It's nice to see people wanting to get involved in the government and you know, be a representative for the people and help their communities. I also wanted to mention the wonderful legislation that's being passed around the country in different states. There have recently, just within the last few months, have been 8 states now that have passed laws limiting abortion, limiting the months. And Alabama went full force, and they've eliminated abortions. And that will probably be the case that will be challenged and go to the Supreme Court, because it's totally, there's no exceptions, and there's, you know, but it's, I wanted to mention the states. It's Arkansas, Utah, Mississippi, Missouri, Alabama, Georgia, Kentucky, and Ohio. So we would like to think that our state would be coming up soon, but I don't know. I don't think our governor would approve of that, but we would hope so. So lots of things going on. I wanted to mention, too, about the rally that was held in Philadelphia last Friday. It happened because one of our state reps, Brian Zims, Representative Brian Zims, videotaped himself bullying an older woman who was at the Planned Parenthood in Philadelphia. She was just standing on the sidewalk praying. And then he also bullied 2 teenage girls who were there with their mother and put it on Facebook. I mean, he wasn't even ashamed of what he did. Well, that caused such an outcry. People are asking for his resignation, and the good side of it was, because people were so outraged, they quickly did a fundraiser to help the crisis pregnancy centers in Philadelphia, and they raised over $100,000 in like 3 days. It was unbelievable.
And in the march itself, the protest itself, there were 1,000 people that showed up.
It was a good turnout. Mm-hmm.
And we didn't hear from him that day.
And one of the speakers that was at that rally was Toni McFadden. And she gave her story about her abortion. It is an unbelievable story. She is actually going to be a guest on our August program with her husband. I'm not going to tell you any more about her story because it's so unusual and so beautiful. But that was that march really struck a nerve in so many people because, you know, our side is always accused of hate and bullying and intimidation, you know, and here it was reversal. And, you know, there's a lot of silence. A lot of people should have been speaking up more and haven't. But
Hasn't
gone unnoticed.
Too.
Yeah, Abby Johnson flew in.
Lila Rose. The unplanned movie was about her.
Yeah,
her
I mean,
story.
It was a wonderful rally. It's you can see it on Facebook if you didn't see it the day of the rally. But there's many Facebook pages that have videotapes of it. But we're hoping that will send a strong message that those of us who do sidewalk counseling, we have a legal right to be there. We have a legal right to be on a public sidewalk and to present our message. You know, we shouldn't be bullying and intimidating, and neither should it be done to us. So we just hope everyone would learn to accept one another and be kind. And we have so many problems in our country that need healing, so many people that are suffering, so much healing that needs to be done. We really need to all try a little harder to help those that are not as fortunate as us. So I guess that's all. Do we have any other?
No, when you're looking at who's going to be on the ballots, many of the districts are going to be having their school board. That's going to be very important.
Oh, yeah.
What's being taught at your school.
A lot of races.
We had the rallies at the Reading High School because the LGBTs were coming in with stories.
And the courts, the state judicial race.
There'll be
the Superior
Court. You'll have to pick out who's going to be on the Democrat Party and who's going to be on against the Republican.
It's important.
Because they're on for 10 years.
Yeah.
So when you have a judge, it's a 10-year term. So it's important that you look now. Because
and then in the fall, I think we get to use the new voting booths.
I don't know.
I think I saw that on the news today. I think it's the fall election they're going to start using. They have new ones out for them. So lots of things going on. We just want to, I want to say a big, big, big thank you because it is now June. Another year has rolled around. We have been on BCTV for 19 years. We started in 2000, and I found the original videotape. It is hilarious. Black and white, and you would be amazed even. It's embarrassing kind of for us, but BCTV has come a long, long, long way in with their technology, the way the programs are produced now versus what they were like, you know, 19, 20 years ago. But we want to thank everyone, especially BCTV, for allowing us to be on the air and to share. Sometimes our issues are controversial. We try to treat all issues fairly and politely, and we thank them for the opportunity. And we thank all our viewers who have supported us over the years and for all the many, many, many guests we have had over the years that have just been so wonderful, that have given so much of their time and their courage, such as Jeffrey, to come on the air and tell their stories, because sometimes it's not an easy story to tell. So we're so thankful and we're so appreciative. And we have some good programs lined up for the rest of the year, so we just hope that you'll continue to watch. So with that, Carolyn and I say goodnight, and we hope to see you in June for our program. We don't exactly have our guests lined up yet for June, but we do for almost the rest of the year. So with that, we'll say goodnight, and thanks for tuning in.
Good night.
Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.